She Walks in Beauty was written by the great romantic poet Lord Byron. He was also known as George Gordon Byron, 6th Baron Byron. He was born in 1788 and he was a British poet and politician who became a revolutionary in the Greek War of Independence. His best known works are Don Juan and Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. They are very lengthy narrative poems, and many of his shorter lyrics in Hebrew melodies are also became very popular. Let's see some info about the poem. She Walks in Beauty is an 18-line poem written in 1814 and published in 1815. This poem is not a love poem, but a celebration of a woman's beauty. But actually, it is said that the poem is inspired by actual events in Byron's life when he met a beautiful woman at a ball. She was his cousin, Mrs. John Wilmont. But some other critics claim that the beautiful lady might be his half-sister named Augusta. Some consider this poem as a tribute to the beauty of the art. Anyway, the speaker never says he is in love with the lady, but he thinks that she is really beautiful. Let me read the poem lines. She walks in beauty like the night of cloudless climes and starry skies, and all that's best of dark and bright meet in her aspect and her eyes, thus mellow to that tender light which heaven to gaudy day denies. One shade the more, one ray the less, had half impaired the nameless grace which waves in every raven tress, or softly lightens over her face, where thoughts serenely sweet express how pure, how dear their dwelling place. And on the cheek and over the brow, so soft, so calm, yet eloquent, the smiles that win, the tints that glow, but tell of days in goodness spent, a mind at peace with all below, a heart whose love is innocent. Let's see the line-by-line explanation of this poem. She walks in beauty like the night of cloudless climes and starry skies. The poem opens with the same verse that from the title, She Walks in Beauty. This sentence doesn't mean that this is a walking of a beautiful woman, nor woman walking beautifully. It is about a beauty is something that she walks inside of. This poem praises a woman's beauty. In this line, the poet compares the beauty of a woman to a knight. You might be thinking that why this poet is comparing the beauty of a lady to a knight. Okay, let's see what kind of knight she has mentioned in this line. Have you ever seen the night with the sky which is full of stars and without any clouds? It will be wonderful to see the cloudless sky which is filled with full of stars look so gorgeous, no? Now we understand well why the poet John Keats has compared the beauty of a lady to a knight. Let's go to the next lines. And all that's best of dark and bright meet in her aspect and her eyes. This line gives the meaning that everything that is great about both dark and bright come together in this woman. Here, aspect means both her facial expression and her overall appearance, which is very bright, and she has very dark eyes. So she has got the best of both, I mean the best of dark and bright. Next lines. Thus mellow to that tender light which heaven to gaudy day denies. Here mellow means relaxed or enjoy oneself. Gaudy means over bright. The poet says that thus relaxed by the tender light, it may be moonlight or starlight, that is less gaudy or bright than the light you get during the day. Let's move on to the next stanza. One shared the more, one ray the less, had half impaired the nameless grace, which waves in every raven tress or softly lightens over her face. where thoughts serenely sweet express how pure, how dear their dwelling place. In this stanza, the poet says that the balance between the shade and night in the lady's beauty is so perfect that if you added one more shade or took away a single ray of light, of the lady would be damaged. Impaired means damaged. The word nameless means something so priceless that can be defined nor expressed as a name. So the poet says that the beauty of a lady is priceless. We could also understand that the woman has a black hair from the expression which waves in every raven tress. The word tress means a long lock of hair. She has a long black hair. Lastly, in the last two lines, where thoughts serenely sweet express how pure, how their dwelling place. Here the word dwelling place means the mind and the spirit. The mind and the spirit of the lady are sweet and pure, with this perfect inner quality added to her external beauty. Last stanza, and on the cheek and over the brow, so soft, so calm, yet eloquent, the smiles that win, the tints that glow. In the last stanza, the poet talks about the inner and outer characteristics of the lady. Her cheek and over the brow. Brow is just a poetic way of saying forehead. They are very calm and soft, even though it is eloquent. Eloquent means here it is expressive. Even her cheek and forehead are soft and calm, it is very expressive. The smile of the lady wins everything. The tints that glow. Here tints means skin tone. So it is very glowing. The next lines. But tell of days in goodness spent, a mind at peace with all below, a heart whose love is innocent. In the phrases, days in goodness spent, mind at peace, and heart whose love is innocent, we understand that the woman's inner thoughts are also as pure as her appearance. Through the line, but tell of days in goodness spent, Byron tells us that it is reflect that all the time that the woman has spent doing good deeds. She is a good person. Not only that, by the phrase love is innocent, Byron means that she is not in love with anyone, but that her love is pure and innocent. In other words, it is not a sexual love. Thanks for watching this video till the end. Bye, have a nice day.